My name is Manuel Silva. Who are you? I'll tell you in a little bit. I just hope I can live up to great expectations. But the first thing I want to tell you folks, since most of you don't know who I am, first thing I want to assure you is, I am not a terrorist. Do you believe me? Do you believe me? Really? You don't know who I am. Why would you believe me if I told you that I'm not a terrorist if you don't know who I am? I mean, don't I look like one? I'm a Canadian, you know. And every time I cross into the United States of America, I always get the look. I remember one time, it was late in the evening, and it was a border crossing just south of Osoyoos, British Columbia, right on the border with Washington State. And it was late at night. We were crossing the border, myself, and that was my beautiful wife there who just sang, and our two lovely children who are here with us. And I remember showing my passport, and I remember they looked at Debbie's passport, and they looked at the kids' passports, gave them back. They looked at my passport and they looked at it again. They looked at me. They looked at each other. They went back to confer with some superior officer. And they came back, handed me my passport and said, "You may go." Whew. Another successful crossing into the United States of America. Last year, we took our youth on a mission trip to Mexico on a humanitarian project. I didn't have my passport this time around. I had lost my passport before leaving, but of course I was assured by my officials that it was just perfectly fine to bring my driver's license and my proof of Canadian citizenship, which I did have. Well, it was fine going into the States, but coming back from Mexico was a different story. And even though it said right there, the country of my birth, and you're probably wondering, well, you're not a Canadian, are you? I had that too. Once we were visiting with some folks in my first district, and a lady and her husband, she was Chinese of birth, and my wife, of course, is Anglo, and we visited with this lady, and the first thing she did when she looked at me, she says, "You're not a Canadian, are you?" And she looked at this other lady who was married to the other chap, and she said, "You're not a Canadian, are you?" She looked at her and she said, "Well, my grandfather was born in Canada and my great-grandfather was born in Canada." She was a fourth-generation Canadian. She just looked Chinese. The book of Hebrews says that God, in times past and in many varied ways, spoke to us through his servants, the prophets. In many ways, over and over again, he spoke to us through his servants. But in these last days, he has spoken to us in the person of Jesus Christ. And I count it such a joy and a privilege, Ty, that I should follow this tremendous sermon, which highlighted just how awesome the love of our God is. Would you pray with me again? My loving Father, I bow before you at this time, dear God, to give you thanks, to give you honor, to give you glory, to give you praise, because you're worthy of it. You are the creator of all that we see. Everything that has life, everything that moves has emanated from you, from this wonderful mind of yours, which is always giving over and over again. That alone would make you worthy of our worship, but today, Father, we don't just give you worship. We give you our love. And we pray, Father, that you will come in and use me to convey that love, that we might understand, that we might come to know what kind of a God you are, a God who is love itself. Thank you, my Father. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Indeed, in times past, God revealed himself through the prophets. But in these last days, he has revealed himself through the person of his Son. He has become the incarnate Word. The Word was with God. The Word was God. Ty did an excellent job of explaining that to you. But I want to share with you why it is that this word was used to describe him at all. The word in Greek is logos. Many of you know that already. But did you know that the word logos was a mathematical term? We use it every time we study math. What are we learning, really, when we're learning math? We're learning how to think logically. Logic, from the word logos. As I did some research on the meaning of this word, I discovered that the Greeks used to use it to render an account of something. Account, that's very interesting. You know, in the Portuguese language, you see, I just told you a story, didn't I? In the Portuguese language, and in the French language, and in the Spanish language, when we want to tell a story, what we do is we count it out to you. Now, for those of you who don't speak these languages, it might sound absurd to you. I mean, what do you mean you count out a story? You measure it out to you. Now, the funny thing is, when I first said this, I didn't really know the original meaning of the word tell until I did some research on it, and I discovered that in English, the word tell, coming from a Germanic background, means literally to count as well. That's why when you go to the bank, who do you see? Why do we call the person a teller? It's the person who counts your money. What did Jesus Christ come into this world to do? To render an account. To count out the story, to tell us the story of his Father. Our Father. The God of love, the God who loves us. Why was it so important for him to do that? It was important because, as Marco pointed out this morning, there are many reasons to question the character of God. There is an enemy who began questioning the very character of God. Back home in Canada, our system of democracy is a little bit different from the American system. And that is, there is one highlight in the day when Parliament sits. There is one point in the day, it happens at 3 p.m. And those who have satellite television often like to tune in because it is the most interesting part of the day on Parliament Hill. It's called question period. And in question period, what happens is that the Prime Minister and his cabinet have to sit down in Parliament, and across from them are the members of the Queen's loyal opposition. An oxymoronic statement, of course, loyal opposition. But the idea is that the opposition is there to keep the government in check. And what they do is they stand there and they question the government about everything under the sun. Why is it that $100 million of taxpayers' money was spent for blah, 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 when it could have been spent for this and this and this and this? And you know, it gets really quite interesting as they go back and forth, brawling sometimes with each other, calling each other names. What's the purpose for that? Why do they do that? Why is it televised like that across the nation? Because there is one purpose, and one purpose only, in the minds of the leaders of the loyal opposition. And that purpose is to take the Prime Minister's seat from him, or her, as once happened for 6 months in Canada. We actually had a Prime Minister who lasted 6 months, and the loyal members of the opposition who formed the majority in the government decided that she did not warrant their trust. The central issue, folks, is an issue of trust. And the issue is, who will you trust to be your Lord, your Prime Minister, your President? Who do you trust? Do you trust somebody just because he says, "I am love"? We heard the singing today, "Jesus loves me, this I know." Why? For the Bible tells me so. Yes, the Bible does tell me so, but how does the Bible tell me so? You see? The Bible could very simply say, God is love. You believe it? Why? Because the Bible says so. Well, how do you know? How do you know? Because you see, folks, 99.9% of the Bible is not statements. It's stories. It's evidence. That we might come to really know who this God is, and to know that he is indeed worthy of our trust. Come with me to a parliamentary scene that happened long, long ago. After the creation of this world, to be sure, but a scene that happened long ago and which will shed some light on the great issues as to why Jesus Christ would have to come into this world. And as Ty correctly pointed out in John chapter 1 and verse 18, it says, no one at any time has seen God. And you think, wait a minute, is that statement really true? Well, of course it's true. The Bible says it. But how do you know that what the Bible says really is true? Is it really true? Come on, folks, let's look at the statement. You say no. Why not? Lots of people before have seen God. When Isaiah saw God, what happened? What was Isaiah's reaction? Woe is me! I am undone! When Ezekiel saw God, what was his reaction? He said he looked like a man, but he glowed like amber. When Daniel saw God, what was his reaction? I fell on my face as though I were dead. No one at any time has really seen God. No one at any time has fully understood God until the perfect revelation of who God is, has come into this world. God himself was the Word. God himself became the one who came to tell the story, to show the evidence that he is indeed one who is worthy of our trust. Job chapter 1 tells us the story of a man whose name was Job, lived in the land of Uz, tells us that he was a multi-millionaire, a cattle rancher, whose millions were measured in the number of his sheep and goats and donkeys and camels, and also in the number of his children. For to have lots of children meant great blessing from God. It tells us, after describing this earthly scene, our eyes being directed to heaven, that there was a day when the sons of God came to present themselves before the Lord, and Satan also came among them. And the Lord said to Satan, from where do you come? And so Satan answered the Lord and said, from going to and fro on the earth and from walking back and forth on it. And now God just couldn't resist. Because you see, God is in the business of helping us and all of creation understand who he is, a God worthy of our trust. Because there is one out there who we are told, according to Ezekiel chapter 28, and according to Isaiah chapter 14, and Revelation chapter 12, one who wants the throne of God himself. One who is a member in this heavenly courtroom of the disloyal opposition. And so God himself takes the initiative. And he starts the ball rolling. And so he says to Satan, have you considered my servant Job, that there is none like him on the earth, a blameless and upright man, one who fears God and shuns evil? So Satan answered the Lord and said, does Job fear God for nothing? Have you not made a hedge around him, around his household, around all that he has on every side? You have blessed the work of his hands, and his possessions have increased in the land. But now, stretch out your hand and touch all that he has, and he will surely curse you to your face. Interesting. Now remember, where is this happening, folks? This is happening in the Parliament of Heaven. Right? The sons of God are all gathered there before the great King of the universe. And before the great King of the universe, the opposer, with the very meaning of the word Satan, the opponent, excuse me, the very meaning of the word Satan, stands up there and he dares to accuse God, and he effectively says, "Does Job fear God for nothing? You're a godfather." You remember The Godfather, the famous 1972 movie. Anybody remember the poster when The Godfather first came out? I was 5 years old. This is all secondhand for me. Right? But the poster has this hand holding puppet strings. Right? The idea being that this guy, Mr. Don Corleone, another one of these Southern Europeans, who many of us think look like terrorists, has all of New York City in the palm of his hand. Right? He controls the police. He controls all the other businesses that he has an interest in. And he does it with a two-edged sword. There's two ways that the Godfather operates. The first way is he stands up there and he says, "I'm going to make you an offer you can't refuse." If anybody remembers the film, you remember that there was this chap who was a movie star, very early on in the movie, a chap who was a movie star. I forget his name, of course, you know, and it's not really that important. The important thing is the concepts that are being projected here. The movie star comes to see him and he says, "I've been denied a pot in the movie." "Oh, really?" So what is he? He sends his consigliere, you know, his Irish-born counselor there, to Los Angeles. Here we are. And he has this meeting with this fella, the great director of the movie theater. And the fella takes him throughout his whole house, gives him a sumptuous feast, shows him his prize, $600,000 horse. This movie was set in the 1940s, so you can imagine how much that horse would be worth today. And there at the table, the man tells him, "The Godfather's making you an offer you can't refuse. You give this guy a part in the movie, you give him the leading part in the movie." And the guy tells him off, swears at him, kicks him out of his house. Next scene, guy's waking up under his silk sheets, and he's just rolling around. He lifts up his sheets and he sees a spot of blood. And he looks some more and he pulls up and more blood, and then a pool of blood, and then he pulls away the sheets, and there is the head of his prize-winning horse. The thing that was most important to him in his whole life, his God, so to speak. The Godfather knows how to make you do what he wants you to do. And the first method he uses is he instills fear into your heart. Do you know, Satan has been very successful in trying to get us to think that God is a God of fear. A fearsome deity. One who thunders. Wait a minute, but he did, didn't he? See, God took a tremendous risk in the Old Testament. And that's why the New Testament says no one at any time has ever really seen God. See? Until they have seen what he's really like in the person of Jesus. Why is God doing that? That's for another sermon. But for today, I want us to focus on the main issues, folks. You see, when we look out at anything that happens, when Hurricane Katrina leveled or flooded, whatever you want to call it, the city of New Orleans, instantly, all over the internet, all over the evangelical circles or Christian circles, you heard that this was because of Southern decadence. This was God coming down, and he was going to strike New Orleans because of this homosexual party that they were having there. And the first question I ask is, San Francisco, Toronto, you know what I'm talking about? And before that, there was the great tsunami in Southeast Asia. And one of the questions that was asked in the media is, what was God saying to Southeast Asia? Just look up your policy, insurance policy, next time on your house. And you'll find that you're covered against everything except acts of God. Who started this business? The Bible tells us that it was Satan right there in the heavenly courts, standing up and saying, you are no good. You are a godfather. The only reason why people will worship you is one of two reasons. That's not the one that he mentioned here. But everywhere else you see, one of the reasons for worshiping God is because he's a fearsome deity, and if you don't bow down to him, watch out. But then, just like every other good dictator, just like every other godfather like Don Corleone, how does one man instill fear in another? How does Don Corleone instill so much fear into the New York police force? How does he do it? Now, God, of course, God could do anything, right? But as far as human beings are concerned, there is another way to get people's allegiance, to get people's cooperation. And that is to grease the palm. Have I got an offer you can't refuse? See? And that's the accusation that Job is making against God right now. Of course Job worships you, God. Of course, because you have greased his palm. You've given him everything he needs. Of course he'll worship you, but take it all away. Take it all away, and he will curse you to your face. And God, shock of shocks, before the heavenly parliament, stands there and says, go ahead, make my day. You know what I'm talking about. We're just using a lot of movie metaphors right now, aren't we? Go ahead. Take it all away. And I can imagine that Satan must have been absolutely flabbergasted by this. He's going to let me do it all? He's going to let me take away all his wealth? Destroy the man? Yeah. Took it all away. You know the Bible story. All gone. The raiders came, stole everything he had. A great whirlwind came, an act of God. Caused the roof to fall on the heads of all his children. He was gone. The man was absolutely desolate. His poor wife comes to him and says, curse God and die. And we all look at Mrs. Job and we say, what a faithless woman. Well, excuse me, folks, but you know what? Ladies, if you'd lost all of your children in one foul swoop, how would you feel? Yeah? It would feel pretty rotten. Job refused to curse God. And then Satan comes back to the parliament and he says, well, okay, skin for skin. Touch his body and watch him curse you to your face. Okay, Job, touch his body then. Touch his body indeed. One strike, and that man was covered with boils from head to toe. He could not sit down. He could not stand up. He could not lie on his back without being in pain. Anybody ever been there? Maybe some of you might have. I certainly have not. I have experienced great pain in my life, but I don't think I've ever experienced anything like that. And of course, the rest of the book of Job is Job going through the angst, the anguish of wondering, why has God done this to me? And the end of the book of Job reveals to us that it was not God at all. Not God at all. So what does this have to do with what I've been asked to preach about here today? Well, Ty ended his sermon by telling us that the cross was the most perfect revelation of the character of God that we have ever seen. And when somebody says that, a lot of people scratch their head and say, how? How does God killing his own son help us to understand these issues? How does that make me draw closer to God? In fact, you know, God takes this tremendous risk in behaving this way because he knows full well that Satan could come around into your heart and say, what kind of a God is that? A God who's going to kill somebody else because of your sin. In fact, let me ask you this question. What kind of a God is it that kills you for sinning anyway? When I was a boy in Portugal, I remember the day that I transgressed the first time that I transgressed one of the Ten Commandments. Maybe it wasn't the first time, but it's the time I remember. An older boy took me by the hand and led me under the fence in our backyard, over another wall, under a fence, over another wall, and we were underneath this amazing giant fig tree. A fig tree. And you say, wow, what's so great about that? You people are so spoiled living here in Southern California, just like I was spoiled living in Portugal. When I preach this in Canada, everybody says, a giant fig tree, huh? I've never seen one of those before. And they had the yummiest looking, juiciest figs. In Portugal, they call them honey drop figs because you actually see this ooze of golden liquid coming out of the fig when it's nice and ripe. And you put those into your mouth and you just chomp on these yummy, just absolutely delectable figs. And we just filled our tummies with them. And we were sitting under this tree, filling it all up. Excuse me. And all of a sudden, we heard a truck go by. Screech! A door opening, a door slamming. Hey, what are you doing back there? And instantly that older boy took me by the hand and I was just like, huh, what's going on? And we ran for dear life over the wall and under a wall and under a fence and over a fence and back home, panting away. And then it hit me, I must have done something wrong. I had just transgressed the eighth commandment, thou shalt not steal. Now just suppose that man had caught up with us. And that man took me and pinned me up against one of those walls that I was trying to climb over. And he said to me, you have stolen my fruit. Shame on you. Don't you know that this is wrong? There is only one thing for you. Stand up and face it like a man, kid. Pow! Shoot you right through the head. What would you think of a man like this? Well, I stole his fruit, didn't I? Wouldn't it be within his rights to kill me? You say no. Most societies on this planet would not accept such a thing. Why is it that we often imagine God saying to Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden, if you steal my fruit, and I do think it might have been a fig tree. The only reason why we say apples is because most of us speak English, and in England the only fruit that grew was apples. See, when you're from Southern California or from Portugal like I am, when it says fruit, I mean, it could have been peaches, pears, plums, anything. You know, at one point in the past, I thought it might have been persimmons because my mother told me about the time she came across a persimmon tree. And she looked at it and the fruit looked so wonderful and good to eat. You know, it sounded like biblical proportions, right? And she took the fruit and she took one bite of it, of this crunchy persimmon. Oh, you know about persimmons. Of course you do. The word for persimmon in Portuguese is diospiro, and it comes from the Greek, and it literally means fruit of the gods. Could that have been the fruit that was eaten? Maybe, maybe not. It doesn't matter, does it? The real fruit that was swallowed was the lie that Satan told them. And the lie was, you can't trust God. He's lying to you. He's trying to close you, pull the wool over your eyes so that you cannot see, so that you cannot realize your full potential. And your full potential is my full potential. I want to be God. Why don't you want to do the same? You see? It is, as Ty said, the me-centeredness, the I in the sin problem. That's the problem. That's the lie that they swallow. That God could not be trusted. And it's the same lie that he was giving to the angels of heaven there in the heavenly parliament. And what's happening here on earth is the working out on earth of those principles that Satan is trying to convince the angels of heaven about. And what we have shown the angels of heaven is very clearly that Satan's principles do not work. But the problem is that God still had to convince us that it wasn't he that was doing that was causing the problem. See? That's why he sent Jesus into this world. And that's why ultimately he sent Jesus to the cross. Come with me to the book of Matthew. Chapter 4. It says here that Jesus was led up by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. Do you know what it says in the book of Mark? It says he drove him into the wilderness. Excuse me? Now, you know, we're talking about the character of God, right? And we're talking about how God is good. Why on earth is God driving Jesus into the wilderness? To be for the purpose of being tempted by the devil. Excuse me? What's this? What's all this about? What's it for? Well, let's read on. It says, when he had fasted for 40 days and 40 nights, afterward he was hungry. Now, I don't know about you folks, but when I first read this, I said, this has got to be the understatement of all. You know, this is one of those passages like, behold, it was Leah. You know, those kind of passages in the Bible that just seem absolutely crazy. You know, how can this be? Yeah, 40 days, the man was the man. Behold, the man. He was literally, Ty, a man. He gave up all of his prerogatives of divinity. He came into this world, none other than God himself, but willingly giving up his prerogatives of divinity, depending totally on the Father, just like we do. And after 40 days, the man was hungry. Oh, I'd say so. Satan comes to him and says, if you are the Son of God, command that these stones become bread. Now, I don't know about you. I have never been tempted by this. I don't think there are any of us who can turn stone into bread. Some of us can turn bread into stones, it's true. But I don't think that any of us can turn stones into bread. But I believe that God can. And what he's doing here is he's tempting Jesus to use his prerogatives of godhood. Why? Let's read on. It says, Jesus answered, he said, man will not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. He quoted the scripture, as we should. And so the devil took him up into a holy city, set him on the pinnacle of the temple, and said to him, if you are the Son of God. Notice how the language is very similar to the Garden of Eden. If. Always asking the question so as to provoke some kind of doubt. Just like the leaders of the loyal opposition in the Canadian Parliament stand up there and they ask questions, but the way they ask their questions are very interesting. Calculated to provoke the maximum doubt in those who listen. Because you see, they want the throne. They want the prime minister's seat. And then he goes on and he says, if you are the Son of God, he took him to the pinnacle and said to him, if you are the Son of God, throw yourself down. Because it is written, oh how sanctimonious of him, to be quoting the scriptures, it is written, he shall give his angels charge concerning you, and in their hands they shall bear you up, lest you dash your foot against a stone. Indeed, quoting the scripture, saying to him, look, Jesus, if you really are the Son of God, you're the Son of the Godfather, right? Surely the Godfather isn't going to let his favorite people go hungry, get hurt. Surely he's not going to do that. Surely he won't do that because he is a selfish God who doesn't want to share his throne with anybody. That's the lie. Okay? And what he's trying to do is he's trying to get Jesus to call upon his prerogatives of godhood so that he will not have to suffer like the rest of us suffer in this world. You see? That's the point. And if Jesus were to submit to this temptation, Satan would go straight back to that heavenly part of him and say, see, I told you so. I told you so. God has his favorites. The Godfather pulls the strings. He does whatever he wants. And those who he greases are the ones who are going to do his bidding. And look at what he's just done for Jesus. Jesus threw himself off the pinnacle and he did not have to face the consequences of God's own law. You see, there's an issue here. Satan says, God's law, it's arbitrary. You can't keep God's law. I have some news for us, folks. God's law is all law that governs this universe. And one of the laws that govern this universe is called the law of gravity. And if you try to break the law of gravity, you get very grave consequences. And I use the word grave in its double sense. You see? But Satan is saying, if you're one of God's cronies, as you most certainly are because you are his son, surely he would never allow anything bad to happen to you. So why don't you go and defy the law of gravity right now? And Jesus' response is to say, it is written again, you will not tempt the Lord your God. But then, the third temptation is that he took him up onto a high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of this world and all their glory. And he said to him, all of these things I will give you if you fall down and worship me. Now Satan is revealing everything. Satan is revealing what he really wants. He wants the throne of the universe. He is already claiming the throne of this earth. In fact, Jesus calls him in John chapter 12, the prince of this earth. How did he legitimately become the prince of this earth? Because Adam gave it to him. When Adam chose to swallow his lie, when Adam chose to believe his principles, when Adam chose to swallow the satanic psychosis, as I call it. That meitis is another term that some have used. Okay? And when that has happened, Satan all of a sudden becomes the king of this world. That's why, folks, when you read about Lucifer and his fall in Isaiah chapter 14, who is the lamentation directed to? The king of Babylon. And in Ezekiel 28, who is the lamentation directed to? The king of Tyre. How can God direct it to two different kings? It's because every king that this world has ever seen, has been under the influence of Satan. Every human being who has ever lived on this earth has been under the influence of Satan. Jesus Christ came into this world to take away that influence. That's why he went to the cross. And what he is trying to do here to Jesus is he's trying to say to Jesus, you don't have to go to the cross. You can have all this world. You can have all these kingdoms, Jesus. Just bow down and worship me, please. The desperation is coming through from Satan now, isn't it? You think that Satan was scared about Jesus going to the cross? Do you think? Folks, after this temptation, what does Jesus say to him? Get thee behind me, Satan. Now, isn't that a nice little King James translation? It loses its full force. Do you know what Eugene Peterson says in the message? Do you know what Eugene Peterson puts in there? He says, beat it, Satan! Because the message was written in modern-day street language. And when we looked it up in the Greek when I was at seminary, we discovered that the Greek word here is the strongest possible word that you can use to say scram! Isn't that right, doctor? Okay. Beat it, Satan. Get thee behind me. This isn't the last time that Jesus would use this word. Does anybody remember when else Jesus said this time? This word? It happened in Caesarea Philippi. I find it very significant that it happened in Caesarea Philippi because Caesarea Philippi just happened to be the seat of Roman authority in Palestine. The throne of Satan, so to speak, in Palestine. And in Caesarea Philippi, Jesus asked the question of his disciples, who do men say that I am? And they said, some say you're the prophet, Elijah, etc., etc. And Jesus says, but who do you say that I am? And Peter, ever the boisterous, ever the courageous one, courageous whether he knows what he's doing or not, he stands up and he says, you are the Christ, the anointed one, the Son of the living God. You are the one who is to be the rightful king. That's what he said in Caesarea Philippi. And the disciples, when they heard this, said, yeah, right on. Yes, this is why we're following him, because we are going to be a part of this movement to conquer the Romans, get them out of town, and make Israel the greatest nation that this world has ever seen. Yes, Jesus, right on. And Jesus says to Peter, flesh and blood has not said this to you, has not revealed this to you, but my Father. I say to you, upon this rock, upon this revelation, I will build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail against the church. Some people look at that verse and they say, well, you know what? That means that no matter what happens to us, no matter how much Satan attacks us, we will be able to withstand. I have some news for you, folks. Well, let me just ask you a question. When have you ever seen a soldier attacking somebody with a gate? Can you see somebody running through the battlefield with a gate? Ah, whack. Chances are he'd never be able to lift that gate. I don't care. I mean, I'm a small guy, I know. But I don't care if you're Arnold Schwarzenegger. Okay? Talk about politics, eh? Nobody uses gates to attack an enemy. Gates are for defense. And what Jesus is saying is that with this revelation, when you accept me as Lord over your life, you will be part of my plan to destroy the kingdom of the devil. And the kingdom of the devil will not withstand you. After that, he spoke to them and he began to explain that he would have to go to Jerusalem. He would be delivered up to the high priests. And that he would be beaten and bruised and then killed. And then he would rise again on the third day. Now, for some reason, they forgot the last part of it. All that they heard was, I'm going to be killed. Now, to them, it must have sounded like utter nonsense. He has just been revealed. He has just affirmed what Peter has said, that he is the Christ. He is the King, the Messiah, the one who has come to be the deliverer, to set those people free and make them kings and lords over the entire earth. And then he turns around and he says, I will be killed. Peter's first response is to come to Jesus, pulled him aside, and it says, the Bible says, he began to rebuke him. Just imagine this. He has just revealed him to be the Son of the living God, the great King, and he's telling him off. Far be it from you that this should happen to you, Lord. And Jesus' instant response to him was, beat it, Satan. It's one of the harshest statements that Jesus ever makes. And he makes it to his closest friend. Fascinating, isn't it? Why? Because Jesus understood what the issue was. They didn't yet. I can imagine that Peter must have reeled from that. Because Peter did not realize that in that moment, in that attempting to rebuke Jesus, he was being used by Satan to try to tempt Jesus from going through with his plan. To die for us on the cross of Calvary. That he might save the entire world thereby. But we still haven't answered the question. How is it that dying on the cross saves the entire world? How much time do I have? See, I'm trying to get two or three sermons into one here. You see, when Marco asked me to talk about why Jesus had to die, I said to myself, oh my. The issue of issues, folks. The greatest issue. Why is Jesus doing this? Why is Jesus going to the cross? Let's go on. Here is Peter again. And Jesus. Remember, folks, what I said. It's the stories in the Bible that give the evidence, not the statements themselves. The statements are only summarizing what has already been learned in the stories. That's why it's so important to study the stories. In my church in Victoria, we go through the stories of the Bible, verse by verse, chapter by chapter, and verse by verse, week after week. And we might sound repetitive, we might be saying the same things over and over again, but it's important for us to get that repetition. How does a child learn? Through repetition, right? We are his children, we need to learn it over and over again. So let's tell the story again. Let's go to John chapter 18. There is Jesus in the wilderness, in the garden, excuse me. And once again, the great temptation comes upon him. There in the garden, Jesus is tempted to let go of all this. He's saying, Father, let this cup pass from me. The weight of it is just too much. It's just too heavy to bear. He's looking forward, looking ahead, not looking forward. He's looking ahead to what's going to happen to him. And he shrinks back in terror. How many of us would choose that? And he says, Father, let this cup pass from me. But he resists the temptation. He says, nevertheless, not my will. And when he has finally come to that moment of choice, there come the guards. And they're approaching Jesus in their rough manners, bearing the clubs and the whips and the swords. And they stand before him, and Jesus, just like in the book of Job, takes the initiative. This is the beautiful thing about our God. God is under attack. God is being criticized. God's throne is in view. Satan wants to steal it from him. God could have just said thousands of years ago, millions of years ago, perhaps, we don't know. He could have just said, Satan, I've had enough of you. You are rebelling in your head. You're causing dissension in my kingdom. Get out of here. Beat it, Satan. He could have said it right there and then. And by saying beat it, Satan, he could have just snuffed him out of existence. And then the other angels would have said, oh my. Oh my. This God is somebody to be feared. Hail Don Corleone. You see, folks, this is the gospel according to Marlon Brando. The gospel that says this God really is a tyrant. You really can't trust him. And you better worship him, follow him, or else he'll just make you an offer you can't refuse. He says to him, love me. You know, Don Corleone said that in the movie. You know, in the beginning of the movie, he had this guy come in there. He wanted him to snuff out a guy who had dishonored his daughter. And he's asking the Don for some help here. And the Don gets up and says, you come to me and you ask me for all of this, but you don't offer me a hand of friendship. The Godfather pretends that he wants friendship. But in the end, all he really wants is control. That's the lie that Satan wants to get into our heads. What does God the Father, not the Godfather, but what does God the Father have to do to prove to us that that lie is not true? Well, he certainly can't snuff Satan out right there, can he? He can't do it, because the minute he does it, Satan has won the game. Satan has just proved, he's just given evidence, and God can say, I love you, I love you, I love you, a million times over. God can say, he can inspire his prophets to write, God is love, 10,000 times. You know, just like you used to do when you were a kid in school and you'd be misbehaved and you wrote, God is love, God is love. God, did you ever write that in school? On the blackboard? But you can imagine what I'm talking about, right? I don't care how often somebody would write God is love on a blackboard, it would not be true, because the evidence would not bear it out. Jesus Christ has come to give that evidence. And so standing there before that mob of brutish men who had been paid off by the godfathers of ancient Israel, he took the initiative, just like the Father had done in the heavenly courts. And he said, who are you looking for? And they say, Jesus of Nazareth. And Jesus says, I am he. The word is added in English. I find that very interesting. Now, of course, in many languages, You don't have to say, I am he, to express that thought. In Greek, all you have to say is, I am, and it conveys the thought, I am he. That's why those of you at the King James Version, you see the he is in italics. But I find it really interesting that Jesus stood there before these people, and he said, I am. Just like God said to Moses, I am that I am. Right there in that spot in the Garden of Gethsemane, he revealed himself to be none other than the living God. And when he did, the Bible tells us that those men fell backwards as though they were dead. They fell to the ground. And you can imagine what the disciples are doing at this point. In fact, you don't have to imagine it. The Bible tells you. The Bible tells us that Peter got up and he went for Malchus and he chopped off his ear. You think he was aiming for the ear? I don't think so. I think that Malchus ducked. And at that moment, Jesus stops him right there, dead in his tracks. And he says, Peter, he who lives by the sword will die by the sword. And he takes up that ear. I mean, think about the living God of the universe. In the person of Jesus Christ, the perfect revelation of who this God is. He's still God. He's still taking the initiative. He's proven that he's still God. He can throw these men over just by the word of his mouth. But he stops and he picks up that ear and he puts it back on Malchus's head. Doesn't need any disinfectant or anything like that. He's God. And he steps back and he says, who are you looking for? And I can imagine he's like, Jesus of Nazareth? I told you, I am he. I am. Take me. Leave these men. Take me. And as he was taken, the king of the universe, the great judge of all, submitted himself to the judgment of a man who should never have been worthy to judge. A man who was fickle. A man who was more concerned about maintaining his position until his furlough came. And keeping the peace. And allowed Jesus to go instead of Barabbas. And the king of the universe was beaten and bruised and wounded. And the Bible says, for our transgressions. How so? For you see, when Jesus Christ was taken up onto that cross, what he was doing was he was revealing to us the very pernicious nature of the sin problem and how far the sin problem will make us degenerate. You see, the death on the cross was not about appeasing some kind of an angry God who's thirsty for blood because somebody stole my fruit. And I demand death. No. What Jesus Christ was doing there on the cross was he was revealing what we look like. He was revealing just how horrible we can be. And just how good and how patient and how kind and how loving God can be. There he was hanging on that cross. And right to the very end, Satan was still trying to get him to come down from that cross, to not go through with this plan. And he said to him, just like he said in the wilderness, if you are the Son of God, except this time he was using human lips. If you really are the Son of God, why don't you come down from that cross? Then we'll believe in you. And he refused to do it. Because had he done it, Satan would have stood up there in the heavenly courtyards and he would have said, told you so. He picks his favorites. The only reason why anybody worships him is because he provides for them and takes care of them and meets all their needs. And that is why in Colossians chapter 1 and verse 20, we are told, and folks, I'm cutting out lots of stuff here. There's going to be question period tonight. Ask your questions. But in Colossians chapter 1 and verse 20, the Bible tells us that it pleased the Father, that this should happen to Jesus. How could God be pleased by this? Because through the death on the cross, Jesus made peace in heaven and on earth. In other words, folks, what the Bible is telling us is that when Jesus died on the cross, he didn't just die for me and you. He died for the angels of heaven too. Because it's the character of God that's in question. And it's the character of God that needs to be shining in all of its light. We can talk tonight about sacrifices and about forgiveness and all that kind of stuff. I'm more than willing to do that. But for today, I just want us to understand, for this moment, I want us to understand that there is a bigger issue than just my salvation. You see? The bigger issue is the salvation of the entire universe in the true meaning of the word salvation. Because you notice that the word salvation sounds an awful lot like salvage. It all comes from Latin, and it means something which is unbroken or undamaged. What has been broken? Trust in God. That relationship that is the characteristic of God's own being, it, in himself it has not been broken, but between us and him it has been broken. And not just between us and him, because the very first thing that happened after Adam and Eve were in the garden and broke their relationship with him by running and hiding from him is... When God challenged them, he said to God, "The woman that you gave to me, she made me do it." And to this day, we guys are still blaming the women. Shame on us. Brothers and sisters, relationships have been broken. The very next relationship that was broken was between brother and brother. And then between the nations. And what God is now doing is he's in the process of putting the pieces back together again. All the king's horses, the satanic king's horses, and all the king's men could not put Humpty Dumpty back together again. But I got some news for you. God the Father can. Not the Godfather, but God the Father can. And I believe he has. And that is why Jesus said in John chapter 12, "If I am lifted up, now the prince of this world will be cast out. And if I am lifted up, I will draw all unto me." Notice that the Greek doesn't say all men. The Greek just says all. Everyone. In my mind, that includes the angels of heaven as well. Brothers and sisters, what about you? Would you put your trust in a God who paid such a heavy price to reveal the nature of the problem to us so that we could understand that he indeed is love? 2 Corinthians chapter 5 tells us that God was in Christ there at that cross, reconciling the world to himself. Therefore, we are called to be reconciled to God. And we are called to call others to be reconciled to God. What is your response to this? Let us pray. Loving Father, how glorious is your name. How wonderful you are, dear God. We have come to this place to know you more. And you, O God, have taught us, as you prayed there in that Garden of Gethsemane, you said, "Father, to know you is to have everlasting life." Father, we want to know you. Dear God, reveal yourself more and more as this afternoon draws on, as this weekend draws on. On your holy Sabbath day, help us, Lord God, to understand and to be at rest in the true assurance, the true rest of knowing that we have nothing to fear from you. We leave ourselves in your hands. In Jesus' name.
Light in the dark.